Hello. Just putting a log on the fire. There. See how we do like something like that. I'm just gonna turn the lights off now. Let's see how we do. By the fire. I guess we'll just sit on the floor next to the fire. Should be okay. Hello. Maybe if I do this, you'll be able to see some things. Heat in the house is pretty well failed. Don't know why. But little of fire. Hopefully it's not too warm for the phone to be that close to the fire. My phones tend to overheat. I hadn't decided what to meditate on, but some of the things that have been going on is, no heat. A little bit of my day, filling my entire day with art. Connected to a few new Buddhist communities today. One politically active, one not. Being very cold. But sometimes I'll start a meditation without knowing what it's going to be. Just kind of recognize, enumerate, consider the affecting elements or facets of the day or week or season or, sort of check in, like, what have I been thinking about? Where has my mind gone? What am I concerned with? Just kind of shape those. I imagine that, if you hired some kind of interior decorator, to redo your house, I imagine that, rather than just having that decorator, I don't know if it's on a computer or a sketch pad or how they do it, but let's say it's a sketch pad. I don't think that they just start a sketch pad and start drawing. Here's what we're going to do, and here's what we're going to paint, and here's the furniture we're going to put in. I think what they do is they kind of start with just a survey and assessment of the personality, the needs and wishes, the budget, but also the space, like what are we starting with? And I don't know this, I'm just presuming. But I imagine part of that is, look, you know, that beam can't be removed. That's a structural element there. Or the most important thing in this room to everybody is that the light comes in. So that's going to affect a bunch of other decisions, or we want a certain thing emphasized or displayed, or that sort of thing. But I think it must start with a survey, you know. What is there to start with before we set ourselves towards change? And so I thought, well, I'm going to sit by the fire and do a little meditation, but didn't have a clear sense, here's the meditation I'm going to do. But I did think, you know, I really tuned into the moon the last few nights. There's no heat in the house. Spent a couple hours. It just absolutely filled me with kind of color, you know, art, I guess. Art thoughts. The Buddhist groups. Ministering to ministers today. Writing some poetry, cleaned the fridge, picked out some paint, you know. Some of those may not quite make it, you know, into the final survey of, you know, what will most likely grossly affect the meditation. But we're just mentioning a few things that were in my field the last day or so. Feeling, you know, the cold. On one side of my body, you're feeling the heat on the other. Kind of thinking, one thing that I learned is that there's no such thing as cold. Like, cold is not a thing, like heat is a thing. And cold is like a colloquial term to describe a low amount of heat. You can't feel cold per se. If you touch something cold, what you're feeling is the thing, the heat, your heat, leaving you. So our language tells us that that thing is cold. Really, it's accepting of your heat, or inviting your heat, or drawing your heat. So you feel your warmth leave some of it at some rate. So, having said that, feeling the cold here, colloquially speaking, let's see if I can just kind of feel how it isn't cold coming from here, it's heat. So I'm gonna just try and tune into the the flow of warmth. Give you a little look at the fire, I think, too. Hey, Saki, how you doing, buddy? You doing okay? He may not come very close to the fire. That's my guess. How you doing, buddy? You want to come over here? You want to say hi to everybody? Well, it's pretty dark, but he's right in front of the camera. Hey, buddy. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, I know it's pretty dark. How you doing? Are you doing pretty good? Come in. I've shifted around because of the cat. Hey, buddy. How you doing? He's right there in front of the camera, but it's so dark. There he is. Now he's sniffing the camera. There you are. Do you want to hop on here? There he goes. There he goes. Come on. Once again, the cat adjusts or dictates our meditation. But that's okay. So since I've reoriented myself because of the cat, who I know that you guys can't see, but there you have it. I've reoriented myself with the fire in front of me. And now he's crawling onto my back. And we'll do the same meditation. Oh, look, there's little filters that I can do, which might give you a little more. I don't know if you can see him there. Yeah. Interesting. I don't know if it's a new feature. There's colors and everything, huh? That's right. We'll just leave it usual. We're still sitting here next to the fire. And the cat's on my back. And I'll do the same meditation, but I'm laying down now to accommodate Saki. The fire's warmer on my face, and it feels like there's cold air on my calves. In fact, it feels very hot over here, not surprisingly, where it probably looks light to you. So that I'll actually burn myself. I'm gonna move my hood a little bit. Which I'm sure you can't see too much. Trying to feel into a sensation I believe exists. Just contrary to the one that I think exists. And that is that when I feel cold moving into me, it's really heat moving in the direction that it feels the cold came from. And I can feel that. I can feel like the cold moving up my leg, you know. But I think I can feel it because I learned to think that. I also think this other thing. And what to try and feel that. Can I feel the warmth from my head, shoulders, cheek, face, and my upper body moving in the direction of the cold? That I'm a circuit for this energy. It's tough because the heat in my head, if I do feel it moving towards my calves, when it gets to my calves, which I would refer to as cold in this house, it doesn't feel like heat has gotten there. It doesn't feel hot. So the heat moving somewhere else. It certainly gets. Less strong, but it feels like it's a different thing, like it's not the thing it was. What my meta feeling about it is that it is heat moving from head to toe. I'm presuming you can hear a little nice sounds from the fire on this meditation. So I'm trying to be a little quiet to let you feel that. Maybe I'll let you see the fire. See how that works. And I'll maybe just be quiet for a few minutes. Balancing on my hand a little. We'll see if that works. It's not perfect, I'm sure. Getting to be winter here, so we may make some fire meditations a bit of a theme. This will be our first.
So even if a cold breeze blows on you, it's very easy to think that there's a coldness that's coming towards you and touching you. And the cold was over there, and then it's come this way, and it's come to you. And it's true that there's air moving. You know, that air moved from there to here. But that air, being colloquially called colder, that air has a capacity to accept heat greater than the air around you, or greater than your body. And so when that air moves towards you, comes in contact with you, or the air around you, the air is moved towards you, but the heat in your area, in your air, in your body, meet that air. They move from you to that air. So we experience that air as though it's bringing this thing called cold. But the air is arriving with a capacity to accept the transfer of heat, the thing that does exist. So when we begin to think of what is cold as a capacity to accept warmth, can be a very powerful shift in compassionate perspective. There's something that seems very cold, some agency, some place, some thing, some person, some personality. When we consider it cold, we can remind ourselves that the colder it is, the greater its capacity to accept warmth. And the very coldness, to use a word, is inviting naturally the warmth that it comes in contact with. So the warmth migrates to balance things. Greater warmth moves to lesser warmth. So coming into contact with something colder, or a mood or personality that's colder, or a person or an agency or an item that's colder, the coldness can help us to recognize our capacity for empathy, the constant tendency of the universe to shift towards balance of its own, without naming, without coercion, without complaint, without delay, without exception. And so I'll just change the view, maybe a little bit, just for variety for folks. Maybe something like this. We'll continue to breathe and see if you can feel the temperature and your immediate surroundings, sort of around your skin. Is there a cool spot? Is there a cool side? Is there a cool direction? If you're seated on a pillow, is the pillow cooler than the blanket that you're also touching, etc. See if we can't begin to make a shift in our compassionate perspective. The coldness, such as it is, it's really just inviting and directing your overfull warmth. It's providing what we might think of as a pressure relief for your warmth, the warmth around you. hopefully we made some sense, even though you probably can't see me. I'm quite certain you couldn't see Saki in this dark. But he's right here, right next to us. I think he might even be in frame. So just do a few breaths. Together. I think this meditation could be done. Laying down, sitting, or standing. It could be a little more difficult moving, but it could be done moving. In fact, I started by sitting and now I'm laying down per Saki's encouragement. It might seem a little silly to think about, you know, touching a rock and thinking of the capacity of compassion or the inspiration of compassion with, you know, the rock. The air surrounding it. And that's reasonable. But it's a far easier practice that way than, you know, starting with, you know, your ex or your estranged father-in-law or what have you. And so, yeah, maybe it sounds a little silly to practice compassion with the stick on your left compared to the stick on your right. It doesn't have to be about the stick. But by thinking of it in terms of a compassionate capacity, it can help us see from that practice with the stick and the blanket, can see from that practice towards a mood, a personality, a person, an agency. So we started with a little interior redecorating, which isn't a bad definition for meditation. We found ourselves considering heat and compassion and the nature of cold. So thank you for joining me. I'm going to say goodnight and either fall asleep here and get burned, but I'm in reach of the aloe. It's quite literally in my reach. Or perhaps a little more likely, Saki will get off me and we'll move further from the fire. He's moving now, just as I said that. Thanks, buddy. Thank you for that. That's very nice of you. Okay. Thank you.